Good evening and welcome to this edition of De Facto Review with Joggle De Facto and myself, Grace Brown, bringing you a weekly roundup of news and current affairs here in Mongolia. You can join us on Facebook at V Television as well as on Twitter, hashtag De Facto, coming up on the program.
The International Monetary Fund arrives in Mongolia to assess a possible bailout ahead of the country's $580 million bond repayment. S. Erdine is elected chairman of the Democratic Party, so what's next for the opposition leader? Mongolia's new domestic violence law finally takes effect. We'll be discussing the changes and what they mean for survivors. And Prime Minister Erdembat approves a new fund to tackle pollution using crowdfunding.
Thank you for joining us. The countdown is on for March the 21st, the day Mongolia must repay $580 million to international bondholders. A team from the International Monetary Fund is now in the country assessing with the government a possible rescue package. Mongolia formally sought assistance from the IMF last year. The country now has a total of more than $23 billion in debt, more than double the size of its economy. 6 years ago, it was the world's fastest growing economy with growth of 17.5%. Last quarter, it logged just negative 1.6%. Joggle, with the team in town and if a package is agreed, do you think that Mongolia can meet that critical first debt repayment in 6 weeks' time?
Well, this is the whole aim. A finance minister announced that we cannot go without IMF package. And most probably they will complete that package, the signing. But from and probably they will be able to pay that 500 to million. But however, $1 million, right? However, the country needs more money. Over easily $1.5 billion, the country needs to just pay the bill.
In the next 2 years, yeah.
Within a short period, probably before even the summer happens, this country needs that much of money. If the government will continue the policy they do now, with IMF package, Mongolia is to pay only people who really needs help, not everybody or every child. And you see, the country's ruling elites were always carrying this policy, like we have always that money from the mining as we had in 2011. Mm. So now it's a big test for the populistic policy of the country.
Right, because as you mentioned, there could be potential austerity measures in the event of an IMF bailout.
It has to be, because IMF understands that this package is coming because Mongolia is accepting this austerity measures. Mm. And the economy needs that too. And also, Mongolia government is restricting prices for electricity, for fuel, that 25% of our export earnings go just for fuel to burn by cars. So, and then yet this price for diesel and gasoline is fixed for already a few years. And when the gas price goes down, it does not change it. Now, when it goes back, the petroleum oil product importing companies are most likely to increase their prices, and it was stopped recently by another help from the budget. There is excise taxes on fuel, petroleum product, and they have removed, abolished that tax, which otherwise could go to state budget to cover other costs. Mm. So in this way, this price limit, price fixing by the government is becoming very expensive. Mm.
So this should be a part of the sorts of things that the IMF may look at.
That's what most probably. And eventually, with the money, when we pay the debt, but actually nothing will be changed in the economy because they're paying the debt by another debt, basically. So the size of the economy, the impact is nothing inside. It's just for outside that Mongolia is paying first payment on time.
Right.
That's all.
Well, looking at the technical aspects of this, B. Batbayer, the executive of executive of the Development Bank of Mongolia, which issued the $580 million bond, pledged that Mongolia will repay this on time, along with Prime Minister Jay Erdenbat, who said that Mongolia has set aside $200 million towards this initial bond repayment already in the state budget. So really what Mongolia, just to meet this payment needs, is $400 million further from the IMF. But also, the IMF will not cover this payment in its entirety. It will be looking to other development partners, other IFIs, international financial institutions like the World Bank and the Asian Development
and
Bank.
We should say it also,
Japan, possibly Korea.
Yeah, it should also comes with first ever Chinese money, which became a part of money in IMF official SDR part of money package, Chinese yen, and I think Chinese RMB, and that also probably will have to do through China with our central bank swap money, several billion US dollar equivalent of RMB in Mongolian economy. The time of payment probably either extended, maybe even the general volume could be even more. So there is certainly a Chinese involvement and content is coming with this IMF delegation and IMF package.
What do you think that China will want in return for that possible extended swap? For example, Bank of China wants to do business here.
Well, that's a big question, is because IMF conditions should not be a Chinese conditions or vice versa. So hopefully there will be less conditions from China if it was otherwise we were directly asking from China.
Mm-hmm. Well, this isn't the first time that Mongolia has gone to the IMF, most recently in 2009 when it received a $229 million standby package from the IMF. Mongolia repaid that during the mining boom. Do you think that we can expect similar revenues in the years to come from mining for Mongolia? Because that's a big part, surely, in its ability to repay its debt. Commodity prices.
Certainly, the economy is different now. We're larger. And IMF packages may be even larger now, if it is coming. I remember at that time it was $280 million just to cover the budget deficit. And this time, the money is not only covering the budget deficit we have, the country, this difficulty, but also that foreign debt. So it all together, IMF policy, I think, principally is to be different compared to the last IMF package, because now you are dealing with the economy mostly charged by foreign debt issuing to the international market government bonds. So it both requires different set of disciplines. Whether Mongolia can meet both, it's double work, double loads, I would say.
I mean, we also need to look at how we got to this point, how Mongolia got to this point in the first place, and whether a rescue package is simply that, a short-term rescue. You know, Mongolia needs to solve the long-term causes that led to this financial crisis in the first place, surely. What are those problems?
Exactly. The other problems is the competitiveness of Mongolian economy. It is a full dependence on mining industry, particularly on three minerals, copper, gold, and coal. And hopefully the prices for these commodities will go up, which is already happening.
That's
now,
right. Yeah.
But it may go down too down the road.
Yeah.
So it is a matter of how Mongolians can diversify the economy first, and secondly, how in general productivity whether it is increasing or not in Mongolia. It's business environment. It's if you regulate prices, it's very hard to have a higher competitiveness.
Right, and a big part of productivity surely is stability in policies. Investors have been given so many mixed signals in recent years.
That's
so hopefully going forward that will change.
What's happening now recently with the 49% of Erdenet shares scandal around and what will be the solution of that issues, it will depend a lot from which the foreign investment sentiment will be changed or dependent a lot. So hopefully the country will go through, but the expectation is the government economic policy will be more encouraging private businesses competition. And for that, the government needs to privatize state-owned enterprises, or because they mostly all the state-owned enterprises have a huge debt too on their balance sheet. So
a lot of inefficiency in SOEs in general. Yeah,
exactly. These will be the long-term measures so that the country is not again in the requirement in the situation as we now.
And in the meantime, a crowdfunding campaign has also been launched by some individuals, including one economist, B. Osogarav, who's donated $4,000, more or less, a gold ring and 10 horses. He's actually made headlines in Hong Kong and the UK and many other places because of this. Who else is pitching in?
Well, another two parliamentarians have given to that common coffin each 100 million Tugriks, around 40,000 US dollars that where the parliament members have paid.
$40,000.
Each of them. And this is the way how people, I mean, there is a will of people, of certain people, to help the government in this time of difficulty. On the other side, many people are not happy with the way how used this first proceeds from the bonds in the country for the last 2-3 years, 4 years. And until we find out what happened with these monies, what happened to these people who have who've been floundering this money. So people, the country, the citizens, they demand justice. Probably it will take quite some time.
And accountability, yeah. Well, moving on, Mongolia's Democratic Party, the main opposition in parliament, has elected a new leader, Mr. S. Erdine. So who is he?
Well, good question. He was a governor of one of the largest districts of Ulaanbaatar City all his life.
Bayangol.
Then when the Democratic Party creates coalition government or own government, then Erdin had always been a minister, mostly social care, minister. And there is a lot of accusation that under his administration, money were misused. And money were, for example, state monies, government money were saved into the private banks with quite a lower interest rate than market interest rate, and it was commanded and it was run, managed by him or his people. This was the accusation he had been receiving, and there was a journalist, Bolorma, passed away last year, and the case is not very clear what exactly happened, but that woman was writing about Mr. Erden misusing the state fund, which went for disabled people's palace, how it was called. And then that journalist went to the place which is next tall building to Shangri-La, tall building, and she found that where is the place or a room or access for disabled people, children, to this palace. This palace is now occupied by the company which is on the name of the brother of that Erden, etc. So this sort of acquisition is very broad, disseminated in the society, and ordinary people were quite surprised. that he won the leadership of the Democratic Party. And there were a couple of occasions where the person was just taking a video and putting on social media that a person from this Erden was asking somebody to vote for him and giving money. So that was the recording. So this sort of
dear. So, different so reactions despite the votes across 21 IMAGs, more than 180,000 members represented, apparently.
He got the largest amount of votes compared to 12, other four.
12 units he won in, ahead of his main rival, Norav Altunhöyük, the former prime minister, right?
Now the issue is, it's de facto, it happened. Now the Democratic Party finally has a chair. Hmm. Now what he is saying that is, now he will be working, consolidating the party, he will change the structure of the party, not clear what structure, and because Democratic Party has always problem with its own fractions, five, six strong fractions, which are fighting among each other.
And he was a member of the Falcon faction, which is associated with the former speaker, Zee Enkbold, correct?
Yes. Yeah. Well, I'm always worried about these fractions in one political party, in particular this Democratic Party, because I don't think the fractions are based on the differences of their values or programs. Mm. They are based on their similarity of their interests, similarity of probably donation to the political parties, and the size may be different, but they are people consisting of who is not happy with the distribution of power when they had a whole political power in the country.
Mm. So do you think that this S. Erdogan will be able to unify the party?
Well, the better he does, because now Democratic Party will play the most important role in further development of political and economic development of Mongolia. It has to, unless they completely lose people confidence 100%. Then otherwise, the next election, they have a good chance to win. And probably they will be also, they will put a candidate for president election this June. Mm. And then they will prepare for next general election in 2020. But by this time, Democratic Party to prove that this is a serious opposition power already, but there are only 9 persons now inside. So we hope, we wish them to be a quite professional opposition. And hopefully, most importantly, this Erden will disclose the party financing of Democratic Party.
Mm. Well, we will have to wait and see. Turning now to a much-awaited move in Parliament, a new domestic violence law, which was delayed last year, finally took effect on Wednesday this week. 1 in 5 Mongolian women, 1 in 2 Mongolian children, and 1 in 4 senior citizens in this country are affected by domestic violence. So, Jargul, how does this new law intend to better protect these people?
Well, first of all, it's a good sign that we have finally approved the law, which was drafted a long time ago, that was ready to be discussed, and which this parliament was delaying all the time, and finally they have discussed. Of course, it's not 100% guaranteeing domestic violence and its violators to be punished. But there are a lot of issues, in particular when they are regarding is it criminal or not in several cases, right?
That's right. I think it's under Articles 120.1 and 120.2 in the Criminal Code, which state that administrative measures, which are fines or warnings, will be taken for the first instance. And only in the second instance, in a repeat offense, will there be incarceration, imprisonment for the offender. So what do you think of that?
So the definition of domestic violence, right? Intimidation, physical assault, sexual assault, controlling behaviors such as monitoring communications, as well as economic abuse.
Economic abuse is interesting. That's quite a culturally significant recognition, because tell us about what that involves here in Mongolia.
It's a matter of, for example, if a husband, or it is a matter, for example, husband or a wife goes and takes pension for the other beforehand, maybe without consent. So somehow there is a flurry terms where the people, it could happen.
Oh, like spending all the household money on booze, for example, and then the family is going hungry.
There is a system called pension loan in Mongolia.
Yes, that's right.
And they may take on the not completely other purpose that pension loan for father, grandfather, mother, grandmother, all pensions get together, they may use for something, and these people may stay without any support, without any material means to support their daily life.
So are there a lot of children in Mongolia who take their parents' pensions without their parents' consent?
It's hard to say without parent consent, but the issue is now parents. Willingly to use their pensions for whatever the children need. As a result, now the rights is completely violated. This person is staying without any material substances. So that's the issue.
It is. And as we mentioned earlier, according to the UN, one in four seniors are subject to domestic abuse in some form here. So possibly that's one of the areas. So, okay, the law also provides for new services for survivors free of charge, including security, healthcare, social welfare, counseling, and critically legal aid. It's interesting because apparently in the past it was difficult when it came to going to court because police often reportedly convinced the victims of domestic violence to drop their cases. So what's changed in the new law is there is a provision that says all victims must receive a hearing in court. I mean, this is interesting. On the one hand, it seems like it might help because it means that unlike in the past, when the victims could potentially reconcile with the perpetrator during the investigation and then drop the case, now it will be heard. But on the other hand, what does this, you know, this could be really problematic in some cases for families.
Because this domestic violence is happening behind the closed door. But the good thing in this law, for example, if the neighbor knew that there is a violence, he or she could hear or hearing. There's no proof that they don't hear. I mean, exactly, there's vice versa. The evidence that they have here and yet not reporting. Then they will have penalty.
Ah, that's interesting.
Yes, so this is a very interesting provisions I would find when the
so everybody in society is now
has to report.
Responsible
yes.
for reporting domestic abuse. And that's interesting. So where can they report it to? Who should they report it to?
Well, very interesting. They can report to police, to everybody, possibly the outreach. They should be reporting to somebody who is to be reported by all means possible, either by phone or go to the local Sumon center, wherever, but it may be an issue of a timing too, but however, that person is to be reporting.
Mm-hmm. Well, and finally, Prime Minister Erdenbat's working group has announced a new initiative to crowdfund solutions to pollution. Mongolia's capital has some of the world's worst air including in some areas more than 30 times the World Health Organization's safe limit. That's in the district of Bainhoshu, and more than 7 times the levels seen in Beijing's recent smog. So, you know, is it possible to crowdfund solutions to everything?
Well, when there was a fund they could not use on time and in the right way, there were several political corruption cases misusing that fund. And it is, I think, an issue of not only crowdfunding. Yes, people will be happy to, in particular, they would call it a fund against air pollution, say. It's one of ways of the calling that name. But this is very complex issues, and this Ulaanbaatar air pollution will be stopped only after majority of population, which is living now in Ger districts,
burning coal,
would have and should have affordable housing, let's say, which has normal running water, and then which has a heating, electricity, central electricity supply. So before the concept was, you know, to make more expensive high-rise buildings and to make immediately beautiful city, which turned out very hard because the scared the street people own their land. And when they, it's a matter when they change the land with the apartments, they value their land differently. There is no market that fixes the market that sets that market price.
Well, one thing the plan also aims to do is ban the use of all unprocessed coal within the next 5 years.
We tried
How
it.
Are
it's
they
very
gonna
hard.
Do that?
Very hard, because they will find a way to bring that coal
to those districts.
It should be certain incentives for them to use it. A lot of this out of the Gedja streets, people at least easily have poor people, easily. And for those people, even they were given particular oven, stove, particular stove.
The clean stove.
Yeah, then what happened? They received it, they have sold it because it was a 90 or 80% subsidized. So because the value, good value is coming 80% subsidized, they took it and they sell it.
So funding is not the only answer. It's also about enforcement. Interesting.
And funding is also not only using this fund for whatever purposes, but it's monitoring who is and how efficiently using. And politicians usually distribute the fund through their governors at the district level. But those people are also using it for political purpose. That's what's happening, unfortunately. And it's happening with a country which has a lot of mineral resources. It's a very rich country, yet that's the situation we are facing.
Well, hopefully they can find solutions, given more than 7,000 people marched against air pollution in Ulaanbaatar last weekend. And that brings this edition of De Facto Review to an end. Thank you very much for joining us. From Jargul and myself, Sahnam Rare. Good night.